Hi everyone. Now we are going to discuss about the topic of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle with Bohr's idealized thought experiment. So before you are going to the topic, you just know the background of quantum mechanics, how it came. So you know well, by 1900, Max Planck discovered the concept of radiation spectrum of black bodies, which occurs only with discrete energy separated by the value of h nu. So he is a man first used the concept of light consist of energy packets, namely as photon. So after few years of discovery of light photons by using by Max Planck in 1905, Albert Einstein have a concept of photoelectric effect, and he proved particle nature of the electromagnetic wave. So by following up there, in 1911, Rutherford performed certain experiments shooting of alpha particles in a gold foil and explain the concept of the structure of an atom consists of a heavy nucleus with positive charge surrounded by negatively charged electrons like a small solar system. So Niels Bohr is a man who is a best follower of Rutherford. When he is working with Rutherford in Manchester, put a mathematical model of the atom by which it provided the first theoretical support for Rutherford's model and could explain the emission of spectrum of the hydrogen atom for Balmer series. So between the years of 1930 to 1925, Bohr, Arnold Sommerfeld and others keep on working to improve the Bohr's atom model, together with the introduction of spin and Pauli's exclusion principle, which gave reasonably a good description about the basic chemical elements. So the model which is explained by the Bohr regarding the structure of atom, it says that an atom consists of positively charged nucleus, whereas electrons are revolving around the circular orbit in a fixed level. So we know that each and every orbit have filled with the number of electrons which is equal to Pauli's exclusion principle. So except the spectra of hydrogen, most of the experiments or most of the phenomena are properly explained by Bohr's atom model. So it was general feeling among the physicists that Bohr's atom model had to be replaced by more radical theory. So in 1925, Werner Heisenberg, who is the assistant of Bohr in Copenhagen, he is the capital of Denmark, who laid down on the basic principles of a complete quantum mechanics. So in his new matrix theory, he replaced classical commuting variables with non-commuting ones. So in the following year, Erwin Schrödinger gave a simpler formulation of the theory, in which he introduced the concept of second order differential equation for a wave function. So on the same year, Max Born proposed a statistical interpretation in which the square of the absolute value of the wave function expressed the possibility amplitude for the outcome of the measurement. So these are the background of how the development of quantum mechanics happened during the period of 1900 to 1930s, and then people started working on it, by means that further improvement are happening. So now we just go with a small recap regarding Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, because we had to think about Bohr's idealized atom model, how to fit. So the act of measuring one property induces an instantaneous discontinuous change in another property of the electron. So this means that it is now impossible to measure simultaneously both the position and momentum of the electron with arbitrary accuracy. So we already known well the product of the errors on position and momentum will be greater than or equal to h by 2 pi, sometimes h cross by 2. So the relation, that is, this is generalized to be a simultaneous measurement of position and momentum. Okay, right. So the relation between the wavelength and its momentum will be equal to p is given by h by lambda, where the electromagnetic radiation or matter particle is happening. So we just think about it, either you are considering of electromagnetic wave using of Compton effect, or you are using of a matter particle by using of a de Broglie established experiment of Davison and Germer, we have the same concept. So similar relation was also worked with respect to energy and time. So it was got the result of the product of error in energy and error in time is greater than, is also equal to h by 2 pi. So it is important to note that an idealized thought experiment, the estimated Uncertainty is not a measure of some random experimental inaccuracy, but rather a fundamental limitation inherent in this kind of measurement. So, Heisenberg's thought experiment does not include the possibility of the electron having a definite position and momentum. It only excludes the possibility of knowing both of them with arbitrary accuracies. So, each and every experiment that serves to provide such a definition of one quantity is subject to particular indeterminacies obeying relation which prohibits it from providing a simultaneous definition of the conjugate quantity. So, this is a basic of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So, you know well, according to classical theory, the state of a particle is fully defined by its position and momentum, and based on the knowledge of the state at a given momentum in time, all its future states can be calculated using classical mechanics. So, the deterministic view is referred to as casuality. But Heisenberg totally rejects the classical notations in principle. His analysis defines a new perspective on what should be regarded as state and explanation. So, an electron exists in quantum mechanical state, one that cannot be fully defined using the classical terms of position and momentum. So, because of the state of the electron is only partially defined and in principle cannot be known with all the details, it also cannot offer an explanation of physical phenomena based on the cause and effect mechanism. So, nevertheless, such a state can provide an explanation by the correlation of observations. So, these are the significant features represented by Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So, now we are start explaining about Bohr's idealized thought experiment. So, the uncertainty principle plays a major role or important role on many discussions on the philosophical implication of quantum mechanics, in particular with the discussion on consistency of the Compagnon interpretation or the interpretation endorsed by the founding fathers Heisenberg and Bohr. So, in known well, Heisenberg is a assistant of Bohr. He worked with the concept of, actually Bohr, he started working with the concept of wave nature and duality for a long period. By 1911 itself, when he started working with the structural pattern, but we couldn't get the exact result. So, in spite of the fact, Heisenberg and Bohr's view on quantum mechanics are often combined together as a part of Compagnon interpretation. Actually, Compagnon interpretation was the first general attempt to understand the world of atoms and is represented by quantum mechanics. The fathers of, or the founder fathers of the Compagnon interpretation here, mainly focused with Danish physicist Niels Bohr, also with Werner Heisenberg and Max Born and other physicists, those are belongs to Denmark country. So, that's a simple representation of Compagnon is the capital of Denmark. So, the interpretation provided or the explanation provided regarding quantum mechanics are simply clubbed as Compagnon interpretation for the due to the contribution provided by Danish based physicists like Niels Bohr, Werner Heisenberg and Max Born. So, in fact, Bohr and Heisenberg never totally agreed on how to understand the mathematical formalism of quantum mechanics, and neither of them ever used the term the Compagnon interpretation as a joint name for their ideas. So, in fact, Bohr once distanced himself from what he considered to be Heisenberg's more subjective interpretation. So, the term is rather a label induced by the people who is opposing Bohr's idea of complementarity to identify what they saw as the common feature behind the Bohr-Heisenberg's interpretation as it emerges in the year of late 1920s. So, as of now, Compagnon interpretation is mostly registered as a synonymous with indeterminism, Bohr's correspondence principle, Bohr's statistical interpretation of the wave function and Bohr's complementarity interpretation of certain atomic phenomena. Okay, right. So we already known well, Bohr and Heisenberg have started working together on analyzing the wave duality nature of the particles or a system. In spite of the fact, Heisenberg's and Bohr's view on quantum mechanics are often to be named as Copenhagen interpretation, but has a considerable difference between their views on uncertain relation was noticed. So Bohr had been particularly concerned with the problem of particle wave duality, that is, the problem that experimental evidence on the behavior of both light and matter seemed to demand a wave picture in some cases and a particle picture in others. So when you consider a particle is always localized, the very definition of the motion of the wavelength and frequency requires an extension in space and time. So Bohr's struggle with wave particle duality had prepared him for a radical step when the dispute between matrix and wave mechanics broke out by Heisenberg and Schrödinger in the year of 1925, from 26 and 27. So the main contestant Heisenberg and Schrödinger, the issue and stake was the view could claim to provide a single coherent and universal framework for the description of the observational data. The choice was essentially between description in terms of continuously evolving waves or else one of particles undergoing discontinuous quantum jumps. So by contrast, Bohr is clearly insisted that the elements from both views were equally valid and equally needed for an exhaustive description of the data. So on his way, the contradiction was the renounced that the idea of picture refers to literal one-to-one corresponds to physical reality. So Bohr tried to explain that there is a no chance of discontinuous charge is happening into the system, whereas we are expecting that there is a positive law of the particles undergoing discontinuous quantum jump. So instead of the applicability of these pictures was become dependent on the experimental context. So this is the gist as the viewpoint of complementarity principle provided by Bohr. So early the Bohr was conceived with the general outline of his complementarity argument in the early 1927. So while he went for skiing holidays in Norway, at the same time Heisenberg started writing about the concept of uncertainty. So once Bohr came back to Copenhagen and found Heisenberg's manuscript, they got an intense discussion. So on the other hand, Bohr was quite enthusiastic about Heisenberg's idea, which seemed fit wonderfully with his own thinking about wave duality nature. So Bohr always presented the uncertainty relations as a symbolic expression of his complementarity viewpoint. At the same time, Bohr is criticizing Heisenberg severely for his suggestion that these relations were due to discontinuous changes occurring during the measurement process. So as per the concept of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, what we are saying is the relations are due to discontinuous changes happening due to the measurement process, but Bohr is denying it. So rather, Bohr argued that the proper derivation should start from the indispensability of both particle and wave concept. So he pointed out that the uncertainties in the experiment did not exclusively arise from the discontinuities, but also from the fact that in the experiment to take into account both particle and wave theory. So this is the clear point what is given by Bohr, which is found successful on explaining the concept of why we have discontinuous change will be there while you are measuring of any physical quantities in the mobile system and the microsystem. So whenever you are saying about complementary principle of Bohr, it's a subtopic of concept explained by Bohr as an idealized system. So in any experimental situation in which a physical entity, matter or radiation, exhibits its wave properties, then it is impossible to attribute corpuscular characteristics to it. So before Heisenberg or before Planck, it was inferred that by the scientist light consists of corpuscles. So whenever you start discussing about the experimental situations, it is impossible to attribute corpuscular characteristics on it. So in other words, the particle and wave aspects of a physical entities are complementary. and cannot be exhibited at the same time. So this is one concept of complementary pairs. So for an example, if you consider a double slit experiment, if you try to define electron trajectory either by closing one slit or by placing up some detecting apparatus, immediately it was noticed that the interference pattern disappears. So that is a simple experiment which proves both particle and wave nature of the light particles named as photons. So the wave and particle picture give complementary descriptions of the same system. So this one is regarding complementary principle of Bohr, what he utilizes to explain the concept of quantum mechanics and uncertainty and measuring of physical entities. So when you start saying about Bohr's idealized thought experiment, so Bohr have a specific view on uncertainty relation. So in his coma lecture published in the year of 1928, Bohr gave his own version of derivation of the uncertainty relations between position and momentum, between and also between time and energy. So it is already informed that Bohr is keep on is about rejecting or refusing to accept the uncertainty relations provided by Heisenberg, because of he were need of a proper experimental proof. Instead of that, a simple mathematical manipulations will not give proper result. So he started to find the relations by using a formula E equal to h nu, it's representing of wave nature, and P equal to h by lambda, which connects the particle nature of the system. So he was noticed that the wave packet of limited extensions in space and time can only be built up by superposition of number of elementary waves with a large number of wave numbers and frequencies. So that means that he derived the explanation of spatial and temporal extensions of the wave packet as delta x and delta t. By means that he found out the term of extension for wave number as sigma equal to 1 by lambda and frequency of delta sigma delta nu. By using up all the by following a Fourier analysis, he found the most favorable case of delta x, the product of displacement and frequency, or otherwise time and frequency, is nearly equal to 1. Likewise, it can be obtained with the problem of the product of energy variation or error in energy with respect to error in time is also nearly equal to h. So he achieved near equal result but obtained by Heisenberg but different manner. So Bohr's analysis simply drops a footing under the Heisenberg's argument, in which he considers the measurement process involving a photon with different momentum and thus denying any wave-like properties of light. So however, Bohr was able to re-establish the uncertainty relations by taking into account of wave particle duality. So on his followers, he recorded two idealized pictures that completely localized particles by means of idealization observation, where you say the error in position will tends to zero, likewise the error in time in measurement will also be zero, and there is that of an infinitely unbound wave. So where we say it is idealization of definition, here you say the momentum, error in momentum will be tends to zero, likewise error in energy will tends to zero, as the extreme cases of a continuum in both uncertainties have finite values. So Bohr given two idealized pictures which for a localized particles. The one is idealization of observation, which related with the particle nature of the system, and idealization of definition, which related to wave nature of the system. So in all particular practical cases, the state of the particle should be represented by a non-idealized wave packet with a finite uncertainty of observation and definition. So he followed with the case of the composition of wave particle in terms of wavelength and frequencies determines the uncertainties of delta of 1 by lambda, is delta nu and delta sigma. So we have a case, the relation between lambda and nu is given by the term the product of uncertainty in position and uncertainty in the variation of lambda sigma, in frequency will be given by nearly equal to 1, or it is delta t in delta nu will be nearly equal to 1. So by assuming that the quantum postulates holds for every component of the wave packet and not just for an idealized wave. So the uncertainty relations directly emerge from the mathematical properties of wave packet spectral decomposition. So thus, while Heisenberg's results still hold under Bohr's complementarity theory, his thought experiment is shown to be flawed. So you just notice that even the concept of Bohr's complementary theory to be still hold good with respect to Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, but have severe flaws that was identified Bohr as it is impossible to measure both position and momentum or time and energy simultaneously with arbitrary precision. So this was the concept given by Heisenberg, but it's not because of the measurement process interferes with the state of the particle, but it is because of state of the particle which cannot have in principle a sharp value of Bohr properties. So that is a clear identification of Bohr, which says that there is an error or it is not at all possible to measure both momentum and position simultaneously with good accuracy. It is not because of the procedure what we are involved on measuring of position and momentum or energy and time of the system. Instead of that, it is because of the state of the particle is not having a sharp edge, either it is acting as a wave nature or in a particle nature. So such a pair of properties that cannot be measured simultaneously are called as complementarity properties. So these are real advantages given by Bohr against Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So that flaw is filled by Bohr regarding of why we are having an uncertainty in measuring the physical entity of the system. So few points about Bohr's view on uncertainty relations. We already known well, Bohr does not refer to discontinuous changes in the relevant quantities during the measurement process. Rather, he emphasizes the possibility of defining the quantities. So Bohr not only rejected Heisenberg's argument that these relations are due to discontinuous disturbances implied by the act of measuring, but also his view that the measurement process creates a definite result. So further, Bohr did not approve the epistemological formulation or one in terms of experimental inaccuracies. So he is always expecting an experimental proof that whatever will be the mathematical manipulations that to be supported with an experimental data. So you may not simply blame with the formulation with respect to experimental inaccuracies. So Bohr always stressed that uncertainty relations are first and foremost an expression of complementarity. So this may seem odd since complementary is a diatomic relation between the two types of descriptions where the uncertainty relations allow for intermediate situation between two extremes. So Bohr never followed the compromise between the two mutually exclusive modes of description in terms of unsharply defined quantities. So Bohr started working the analysis either of the particle or the system or object in wave nature or in particle nature. He never accepted the mathematical equation which relates that discontinuous disturbances plays a major role on defining the result of the experiment. So this one is the view of Bohr on uncertainty relations. So now we are just going to explain the Bohr's idealized thought experiment by means of Bohr's view on complementary and interpretation of quantum mechanics by 14 points as explained by Bohr. So the first one is the interpretation of a physical theory has to rely on an experimental practice. The very first point raised by Bohr, here we are saying about interpretation of any physical theory or mathematical implementation on an experiment, it should rely with experimental practice. The next one, the experimental practice presupposes a certain pre-scientific practice of description which establishes the norm for experimental measuring apparatus and consequently what counts as scientific experience. So whenever you start saying about an experimental practice is to be applied, then you have to be ready with, you have to be maintained with a certain pre-scientific practice of descriptions which establish a normal experimental procedure and apparatus conditions, and consequently what counts of scientific experience you can achieve from the particular experiment. Likewise, the pre-scientific practice of understanding environment is an adaptation to the sense of experience of separation, orientation, identification and re-identification over time of physical object. So the pre-scientific practice must be utilized for the understanding of the environment and also to adapt the sense of experience with respect to separation of particles or orientation or identification of particle and re-identification of particles over the time of physical objects. So this pre-scientific experience is grasped in terms of common categories like things, position and change of position, duration and change of duration, and the relation of cause and effect and terms and principles. So you just find a case, there are some pairs of common categories like complementary pairs. We have position and change in position, likewise time, change of duration, duration and change of duration, likewise cost and effective and effect of the experiment or the result, and terms and principles are to be grasped as a common category for any experiments. So the fifth one is, the common categories yield the preconditions for objective knowledge, and any descriptions of nature has to use these concepts to be objective. So whatsoever the categories we studied, the four categories what we studied in the last point, yield the preconditions for the objective knowledge. So whatever we are start doing of an experiment, we need of objective knowledge. So that provides a clear description about the scientific conditions or pre-scientific knowledge. So the concepts of classical physics are merely exact specifications of the above categories. So it is a main, the most important point what is raised by Bohr is, the concept of classical physics or classical mechanics are mere exact specification of the above categories. So he never want to leave or left the classical mechanics as done by Heisenberg's, because Heisenberg's never accept classical mechanics, because he started deriving of new theory of relativity, a new theory, a new concept of mechanism called as quantum mechanics by the following of uncertainty principle. So what he says is, the classical concepts are necessary in any description of physical experience in order to understand what we are doing and to be able to communicate our results to others, in particular in the description of quantum phenomena as they present themselves in experiments. So Bohr highlights that the classical concepts must be required to describe a physical experience to understand what we are doing and how to be communicated with other people regarding the result and what may be the effect of quantum phenomena while comparing with classical phenomena. So Planck's Bohr also highlights that Planck's empirical discovery of quantization of action requires a revision of the foundation for the use of classical concepts, because they are not at all applicable at all the time or at the same time. So Bohr totally rejects the concept of Planck's empirical discovery of quantization of action. So their uses is well defined only if they apply to experimental interactions in which the quantization of action can be regarded as negligible. So this one is Bohr's thought regarding Planck's empirical relation is about Planck's constant. So likewise, in the experimental cases where the quantization of action plays a significant role, then the application of a classical concept does not refer to independent properties of the object. So rather, the ascription of either kinematic or dynamic properties to the object as it exists independently on a specific experimental interactions is ill-defined. So in an experimental case where the quantization action plays a significant role, means we have to work out with the application of classical concept does not refer to independent properties of the object, whereas it is a description of, you can you start running of kinematic and dynamic properties of the object, means it should exist independently while comparing with experimental interactions, which may be termed as ill-defined. So the quantization of action demands a limitation of the use of classical concepts, and so these concepts apply only to the phenomena. So which Bohr understood as a macroscopic manifestation of a measurement on the object, which to be termed as an uncontrollable interaction between the object and the apparatus. So the quantization of action demands the limitations. So whatsoever the system we are expecting with quantization, so we have some limitations regarding the use of classical concept. So that classical concept to be applied with a phenomena by means that we can create the manifestation of the macroscopic system of measurement of the object. So this one is the backup what is required on quantization of action and for any macroscopic manifestation system. So the next one is the quantum mechanical description of the object differs from the classical description of the measuring apparatus, and this requires that the object and the measuring device should be separated in description, but the line of separation is not the one between macroscopic instrument and microscopic object. So just find a case whenever you start working with the macro quantum mechanical description, then the object must be differed with respect to classical description of measuring apparatus, and then you have to explain about quantum mechanical description of the requirement of the object and the measuring device. So that separation should not be related with respect to macroscopic instrument to analyze any microscopic objects. So that line of sight to be followed for the measuring of or for analyzing the quantum mechanical treatment of microscopic particles. So the next one is the quantum mechanical formalism does not provide physicists with a pictorial representation. So the psi function does not also records as Schrödinger had hoped represent a new kind of reality. The Bohr said that the quantum mechanical formalism does not provide physicists with a pictorial representation, as the function psi does not provide what Schrödinger explained regarding the wave function to represent a new kind of reality. This one is the idea provided by Bohr. So the ascription of these classical concepts to the phenomena of measurements rely on the experimental context of the phenomena, so that the entire setup provides us with the defining condition for the application of kinematic and dynamic concepts in the domain of quantum mechanics. So if you are saying about we are just going to describe a classical concepts to the phenomena of measurements which rely on experimental context of the phenomena, then we should provide the entire setup for defining condition for the application of how it is working with kinematics and dynamics of the particles in the domain of quantum mechanics. So yes, like what we are describing the concept of movement of particles or kinematics of the system of the object in classical mechanics, likewise you have to explain in quantum mechanics. So such phenomena are complementary in the sense that their manifestation depend on mutually exclusive measurements, but that the information gained through the various experiments exhaust all possible objective knowledge of the object. So whenever they start explaining the concept kinematics and dynamics of a defining condition of the application, defining conditions of any physical phenomena, it should be noted that the concept of the sense of manifestation is purely depending upon mutually exclusive measurement, but that the information gained through various experiments which to be exhaust all possible objective knowledge of the object. So you must note down all the various possible objective knowledge of the object, then only just started working with the explanation of the experimental phenomena defined by classical mechanics or by quantum mechanics. So these are the 14 points derived by Bohr regarding his regarding the concept of Eisenberg uncertainty principle or the interpretation of quantum mechanics. So this is the final summary regarding the Bohr's idealized thought experiment. So he said Bohr thought of the atom as real, definitely. So atoms are neither heuristic by means of it had to be a problem approaching nor logical constructions. A couple of times he emphasizes this directly using arguments from experiments. So much of arguments are done by Bohr regarding the concept of structure of atoms and wave particle duality nature. So it is because of the imaginary quantities in quantum mechanics where the commutation rules for canonically conjugate variables is about does not give us pictorial representation of the world, quantum world. So what he says that if you start analyzing with only the imaginary quantities in quantum mechanics, so the commutations of canonical conjugate variables like P and Q, which induces Planck's constant into the formalism, where the quantum mechanics does not give us a clear pictorial representation of the quantum world. So in general, Bohr considered the demand of complementarity in quantum mechanics to be logical, on a par with the requirements of relativity in the theory of relativity. So Bohr believed that both theories were result of novel aspect of the observation problem, namely the fact that observation in physics is context dependent. So Bohr clearly believed that the theories were a result of novel aspects of the observation problem, but that observation should be led with a context dependent, result oriented analysis of the particular phenomena. So each and every experimental procedure should be a context dependent, by means that that context will be explained on the basis of physical phenomena or physical theories of the physical theories. So that is a concept given by Bohr. So this one is a full of theory part. I think understand the topic well. So we'll meet you soon with the next topic. Thank you.